To come and share with Abounding Grace this morning, amen, that you chose to be in the house of the Lord this morning, amen, the house of worship, the house of prayer, amen. The Bible teaches us not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together, so it is good that we assemble together, amen,
amen,
amen. It is good that we come together. Now, I know we've come, amen, because today is Christmas, a day that we remember Jesus Christ, the birth of our Lord and Savior. Jesus Christ, although we know he wasn't born today, amen, and that man just set this day aside, we'll take advantage of it because he set it aside, amen?
Amen.
But as believers, we know every day we celebrate Jesus, right? Every day is his birthday to a believer, amen?
Amen.
Because we're thankful that he was born. We're not only thankful that he was born because God never told us to celebrate his birth, but he told us to celebrate his death. It is the death of Jesus Christ. Had he not been born, he'd have never died. Amen. Had he not been born as the Son of Man, he never know how you feel right now. But he knows how you feel right now because the Bible said we can touch him with the feelings of our infirmities. Amen. So whatever you're going through today, Jesus knows about it. And not only does he know about it, he is compassionate about it. Amen. And he loves you. Say, he loves me. Yes, he loves you. Amen. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believe in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. To God be the glory. Amen?
Amen.
You know, on that day when Mary and Joseph traveled back, amen, to Bethlehem, to that area, it was simply because they had to be counted, because of the census, they had to be counted. So everybody had to go back to where they came from, amen, so that they can be counted. Praise God, you come today back where you belong. And that's in the presence of God so that you can be counted. Amen? Don't we all want to be counted? You know, when Mary got there, the innkeeper told Joseph that he didn't have any room. Didn't have any room for Jesus. So they gave him a little place out back, amen, where he could be born. A little manger out back. And, you know, that's kind of unusual for a king to be born in that sort of place. But Jesus was born to die. He was born as the Lamb of God that would come to take away the sins of the world. Amen? So it's right that he would be born in other places where lambs were born, right? Because he was born to die. Praise God for Jesus. Praise God for Jesus. Praise God for Jesus. The innkeeper had no room for him. But we certainly got room for him, don't we?
Amen.
Don't you have room for him today in your heart?
Yes.
Amen. Say with me, say, Jesus,
Jesus,
I got room for you
in my heart.
Amen. Amen. And he said, if you make room for him in your heart, he'll come and dwell with you. He'll come and live with you. He'll not only do that, but he'll give you a new heart for the one you got. And he'll give you a new spirit. Amen. Praise God. It was David that prayed, said, Lord, give me a clean heart and renew a right spirit within me. So when Jesus comes into our heart, we don't want to have the same heart. The heart of unforgiveness, the heart of unbelief, the heart of doubt. We want to have a heart where he can come and dwell. A mind where it's no longer our mind, but it's his mind. No longer our thoughts, but his thoughts. Amen? That's what we want. That's what we want to have. And that's why Jesus came. That's why God gave us this wonderful promise. Amen. He loved us so much that he knew that had he not gave us Jesus, that we would be lost forever. He had tried everything, amen, to redeem us, everything to bring us back in the fellowship with him. And we just couldn't do it. Amen. We were too corrupted. The seed that was in us from the fall of Adam had corrupted us so that we needed a Savior. And we needed someone that could come and redeem us, amen. Someone that could come and buy us back, for we had been punded. And somebody needed to go to the pawn shop and redeem us. And Jesus had to slip. And he came and he redeemed us. Amen. With his own blood, he redeemed us, amen. Praise God. He was the Son of God, but he was also the Son of Man, but he was also the Son of God. And praise God that he was the Son of God. Had he not been the Son of God, he would have never been able to get up out of that grave and go down to hell and kick the door in and take the keys from hell and death from the adversary. Amen. and defeat the adversary, for he is defeated today for every blood-bought believer, amen? For every believer in Jesus Christ, Satan is defeated and Jesus is Lord. Amen? That's why you're healed today. Amen? That's why you're more than a conqueror today. Amen? That's why you're the head and not the tail, amen? Praise God. That's why every need in your life is met according to his riches and glory. Amen? Amen. I had a Christmas message that I had put together for today, and Lord told me, just put that to the side. Amen. And when he get ready for me to preach that one, he'll tell me to go get it. Amen. You know, sometimes we believe that we got to follow the pattern of what man has set, but we can't do that. We must be led by the Spirit of God. Amen. Amen. The children of God are led by the Spirit of God. How many children of God we have here? Amen. Praise God. Well, that means your hearts are open today, amen, to hear the word of God. You know, and it's not unusual that God would give us his word because, you know, prayer for 2017 is serious with God. It is important to God. I shared with you on Wednesday night, if you were here on Wednesday night, that God had been tugging at my heart, you know, on the corner of Broadway and Hollywood. And when I passed that corner, and I'm so thankful that our church is located where it is, amen, because we're located in a place where mission and vision takes place, amen. You cannot leave here without seeing the mission of God and without seeing the vision of God, and that is that folks would be saved. You know, people in this community in some cases are in despair. Amen. They're living in hopeless situations and in hopeless conditions. Amen. And they're only like that. It's only like that because the church has not stopped to pray. It's because we get in our cars and we leave from this place and we go to our safe communities and our safe homes and we just come back here and lock ourselves up in this building and we do the same thing over and over again. Amen. And God is saying to us that we got to come out of this building and get into a place where we can begin to pray for this neighborhood and pray for this community. And that's going to be the vision for 2017. And we're not going to just talk about it. We're going to be about it in 2017. Amen. So, you know, in the last 3 weeks or so, I've been passing the corner of Broadway and Hollywood, and there's a little black building that sits over, used to be a tire shop right there on Broadway and Hollywood. And on the other three corners of that intersection, that crossroad, there's liquor stores and you know, and there's all sorts of things that happen on that corner. I know because as a fireman, I would respond to that corner a lot for people that had been shot, people that had overdosed, or people that were beaten or something like that, or even to that clinic where people were so sick that the clinic couldn't take care of them and we had to go in and transport them to a facility that could take care of them. So that corner represents a lot of different things that makes up the world, and it represents death. It represents a loss. It represents poverty. It represents despair. It represents drugs and prostitution and all of those things. It represents on those three corners. And every time I cannot leave this church, go that way and make that green light. I've been able to make that green light here lately. But God would stop me at that red light, and he would always put me in a position where I would see something on that corner that would draw me to pray. And then he would show me that corner that was vacant. And I didn't know what he was tugging at my heart for until I began to pray. You know, God will show you something. He'll give you the first little glimpse of it. But until you begin to pray, will he show you the plan? He don't show you the plan. He don't show you the full plan because he don't know that you're on board to do it. But when I begin to feel the tug and I begin to pray for that corner, God began to show me that was a corner that Abounding Grace would take over this year, and that we would begin to pray on that corner. We would begin to have prayer meetings on that corner, and we would begin to lift up God on that corner. Amen. Praise God. And that where there is darkness on all three corners, we're about to bring the light. Amen. We're about to bring the light. Amen. And I'm telling you, we're gonna bring the light, and when the light comes, people who are in darkness will be drawn to the light. Amen. People who are in darkness will be drawn to the light. People cannot be drawn to light where there's no light. And on that corner, there is no light. There is no light. But once we take over that corner, and we're going to take it over, and I said we're going to take it over, amen. We're going to take over that whole intersection, amen. And we will begin to pray. And when we begin to pray, we're going to see the hand of God move. I tell you, when God's hands move, something's going to happen. That place that's occupied there, that's seeing a lot of sick people in those other two corners where all the you know people are just intoxicated and out of their mind, you know, and those corners represent nothing but death. But our corner is going to represent life. And it's going to represent the life. And I begin to share that in this church on Wednesday night. And you know, I begin to pray about it. And God showed me to pray. And he showed me to share it with the church. And then he said, the next thing, you got to find out who owns that corner. And so in prayer, in service on Wednesday night, I began to share it. And then Sister Janita told me after service, she said, Pastor, I know who owns it. You see, when you begin to obey God, he'll show you what to do. And so she gave me the person's name. She called him, and it was okay for me to call him. And I called the person that owned it, and he directed me down the path of talking to his partner. And I did that, amen, spoke with his partner and a couple of partners in the project. And they talked to each other and said, we can use that corner anytime we want to use it. Amen. Now listen, I knew that was going to happen, amen. I told the man exactly what God had told me. That God told me it was darkness on that corner, and that lot represented a place where we could occupy and begin to pray, and that the light, he could not deny it because it's in God's plan. I wasn't expecting to debate with him or to negotiate or anything like that. I expected him to say exactly what he said, amen? Because listen, when God gives you a vision, he also provides the provision for it. And all he's looking for you to do is to move ahead, amen? He ain't shown me the whole plan, amen. Because he'll never do that. Because right now I can get excited and stop. And God said, I'm not going to waste my breath showing you everything. So the next thing to do is to set a committee up.
Come on.
And I'm praying that some of you will say, Pastor, I want to serve on that committee, that prep committee. Because we're going to set a committee up, and we're going to identify when we're going to go to that corner of Broadway and Hollywood, when we're going to be there, and how often we're going to be there. But I'm telling you, we're going to be there often, amen? We're not going to just go there and show our faces occasionally. We're going to go there until something happens.
Amen.
I'm telling you, until something happens, until something breaks loose, until the hand of God moves, until people on that corner walk across the street and fall on their knees and cry out and say, what must I do to be saved, amen? Until people who are on drugs, amen, come off of drugs, amen. Until the traffic on that corner decreases, amen. I'm telling you, we're going to pray, and that's going to happen.
Amen.
Hey, I know you don't believe it, but I'm telling you, it's going to happen. Amen. It's going to happen, amen.
Amen.
It's going to happen. Because we are the light of the world.
Amen.
We are the light of the world. And all these little ships that are out there that's trying to make it in, but they can't make it in because there's no lighthouse. There's no light. They can't see any light. Amen. They're out there crashing into each other. They can't find the channel because we're not the light. We're going to be the light on that corner. And there's going to be a channel, and people are going to know how to make it to back to God. Amen. People that have left God will know how to make it back to God. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
Come on, give the Lord a hand of praise. Hallelujah. Amen. Pastor Monique's going to come after I preach, and we're going to pray on that corner. And we're going to pray on that corner. And if you're interested in serving on the committee, you're faithful, you want to serve on that committee, I want you to get with Pastor Monique and let her know. We're going to set a meeting up the first of the year. And we're going to set a meeting up, and we're going to identify what we want to do. What we're going to do on that corner and how we're going to do it and how often we're going to do it. Praise God.
Amen.
And we're going to have revivals on that corner. We're going to have Bible studies on that corner. We're going to pass tracks out on that corner. We're going to put banners up on that corner. When we leave that corner the first time, they're going to know that Jesus has been there. They're going to know that Jesus has passed by right there. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Come on, give a lot of shout of praise. Sitting here, amen, and to feel like we've done something if we feed somebody, amen. But the government give you free food, amen. But the government can't give you Jesus, amen. They give you cheese and milk and all that stuff, but they can't give you Jesus, amen. So we're not satisfied with just cooking food and passing out dinners, amen, and thinking we've done something, amen. We got to get people back to Jesus, amen.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. So God gave me this word, God is bound by his word. God is bound by his word. It's a word I had to pray on right here. It's a word I had to go into my closet this morning and say, Lord, now is this right? Is this what you want me to say this morning? This boldness, am I right in what I'm saying? And God shared with me, he reminded me that nothing happened in the Bible. No one prayed in the Bible. There were no prayers that were answered in the Bible that God answered based on pity, sympathy, and emotions.
Amen.
There's no prayers that anyone carried to him that God responded because they're in a pitiful situation. Or God responded because of sympathy. Or God responded because of their emotions. They were crying. Now, he pities us. But he only holds himself accountable to the word that he has already spoken. And if we don't cause God to be bound to his word, amen, we cannot expect God to do something.
Amen.
And I want to show you this morning in the word of God, in this Bible, and this is what I came out of my closet believing, it was that it's the right word. It's the right word because it's in the word of God. Amen. It's the right word. And it's preached. I'm preaching, although I may sound bold and like I'm up in God's face today, I'm not. I'm just being obedient and I'm being merciful. Amen. And I'm coming to God with my heart broken. Amen. But this is something God wants us to know in 2017, in 2016, 2017. It's something he wants us to know. Because more than ever, you hear people say, I've been praying and God is not answering my prayer. I've been going to God and he doesn't hear me. I don't pray anymore because God doesn't hear me. You hear people say that all the time. I don't hear God and God don't answer my prayer. Well, God cannot answer prayers that are not petitions, that are not fixed in your heart and fixed in you believing that what he has said he is going to do. Praise God. God answers by his word. God is bound by his word. So don't approach God without a promise.
Come on.
Don't approach him without a promise. Don't go to God's presence without a promise.
Amen.
You cannot go into your closet, into your prayer room any longer without a promise, without knowing what God has said.
Amen.
You must know exactly what God has said so that when you go in that closet, you're able to be bold with your prayer. There is no attorney that any of us would hire, amen, that we want an attorney that's going to do a case study. That when he goes in, he's got his brief filled with cases that have already happened that's similar to what we need to happen. Because he knows that when he presents that case before the judge that has already been rendered in favor, amen, that judge is going to render the same call on his.
Amen.
Right.
And so we've got to be like attorneys. We've got to be like lawyers. And we've got to find in the word of God things that God have done. You need God to do something, you got to find where he's done it before. Because if you can find where he's done it before, he'll do it again.
Right.
Because he holds himself. You got to find a promise, something God has promised. Whatever God has promised to do, it will not return unto him void. If it has come from his mouth, he is going to perform it.
Hallelujah.
It will not return unto him empty. Amen.
Amen.
And many of our prayers are simply based on pity and sympathy and emotions. And we cry and we think that God is going to be moved by that. God is only moved by his word.
Hallelujah.
He's only moved by his own word. Amen. He is the king of his word. He's the law. He's the king of the laws that he has spoken. He's our father, but he's a king also.
Amen.
And his words that have been spoken from his mouth represent law. It's just like gravity. If you throw something up, it's going to come down. And God's word is the same way. Whatever God has spoken, it is spoken. And he said he will not alter it, nor will he change it.
Amen.
Praise God. So that means we got to do our homework.
Come on.
That before we go pray, amen, we can go pray boldly. Do you know when lawyers go to court, they go boldly to court?
Amen.
I don't want a lawyer that kind of comes, he don't know exactly what the outcome's going to be. I want a lawyer that's got some cases in his briefcase that can give you the confidence that this is going to work. You're going to be let go. You're going to be turned loose.
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
We are not to console our flesh whenever we're going to God. So we're going to learn how to not console our flesh.
That's right.
Sometimes you're going through problems. You got issues in your family, issues in your body, and you measure those with your prayer. And God doesn't want us to measure.
Yeah.
And the only reason you measure, the only reason we measure those things and we take those things into our prayer room is because we just believe we can say, God, you know, I'm not that good, or I haven't been that good, so take that into consideration and forgive me and do this for me. But there's no room for your problems in your prayer closet.
Come on.
There's no room for what you're going through, because God has already forgiven you of it. If you've asked him to forgive you, if you repented, there's no room in there. There's no reason to carry my problems in there with me asking God to do something. Because God has nothing to do with God moving, because God holds himself accountable to what he has said, not what I've done.
Amen. That's right.
Praise God. In Hebrews 4:16, it says, let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in times of need. Amen. So he said, let us do what? Come what? Boldly. Boldly. And I know that we've talked about this before. Amen. We're going to talk about it a little different today. Ephesians 3:12 goes on to say, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence by the faith of him. We have boldness and we have what? Confidence. And the confidence that we have it in God.
Amen.
Why do we have it in God? Because we've spent time with him.
Yeah.
Because we know him. We know his character. We know what he will do. We know what he won't do. How do we know that? Because we've read about what he's already done.
All right.
And if he's done it before, he'll do it again. If he's done it for that generation, he'll do it for this generation. That's what I'm expecting God to do. I'm expecting God to heal on that corner like he's healed before. Deliver like he's delivered before. If he did it before, and I can find it in his word, he will do it again. He's bound to do it again. He's bound to do it. Hallelujah. He's bound to do it. And I'm going to hold him to it. He wants me to hold him to it. He wants me to hold him to it. Oh, but your flesh says, wait a minute, hold up. That means you're consulting your flesh.
Come on.
That means you're bringing your flesh into play. God said he don't need your flesh. He don't need your emotions. The same emotions that are telling you not to come to God and not to be bold with God is the same emotions, amen, that God doesn't want in your prayer room. God said, no, you come boldly.
Amen.
There's a devil that's attacking. Come boldly. I don't need any crab babies. I don't need any tender babies. I need some bold men and women that will know my word and have confidence in my word and have confidence in what I said. I wouldn't tell you to come boldly if I didn't want you to come boldly. Hallelujah. God didn't say go boldly to your neighbor. He said come boldly to me.
Amen.
Come boldly to me.
Hallelujah.
Glory, hallelujah. And Acts 10:20, it says, arise therefore and get thee, tell Peter, get thee down and go with them, doubting nothing.
Amen.
That's what God is saying today.
Yeah.
Arise and go. You got a petition. You got a word. You know I've said it. You know I've spoken. Arise and go, doubting nothing.
Amen.
Don't consult. Don't inquire.
Come on.
Of your flesh. Don't measure your problems, your issues. Leave them outside the closet.
Amen.
If you're in need, leave it outside. God will meet that need.
Amen.
You can find them. When you want to deal with that need, let it be you're dealing with that need, because that's what you're going to God about. Lord, you said you'll meet all my needs according to your riches and glory. And God said it because the Bible was inspired by God, written through the Holy Ghost, by the Holy Ghost, through men. So if it's in the Bible, God ordained it to be there.
Amen.
He said he'll meet your need according to his riches and glory. Praise God. That's a promise. So take your needs to God with that. Bound him. Let God be bound by that.
Yeah.
Amen. God, you said it. Your word said it. Your word said my needs are met according to your riches and glory. Hallelujah. I'm expecting you to do it.
Amen. That's right.
Praise God. Glory. Lord, God loves it when we do that. He loves it when we do that. Boldness in prayer. In James 15, amen, it says, and the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up. And if he have committed sin, they shall be forgiven him. Confess your faults one to another, and pray one for another, that ye may be healed. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. What does it mean, effectual? Effectual, it means to be fixed. Have a fixed position.
Glory.
It means I know the word of God and I'm fixed on the word of God.
Amen.
My mind is made up that this is what God has said. My mind is made up that this is what God wants me to do. I am fixed on it. You cannot change my mind. I know this is what he says. That's effectual. So when you go to God with an effectual fervent, you are persuaded.
Amen.
You are persuaded.
Hallelujah.
God said, I don't need to be persuaded. We sometimes pray trying to persuade God. God said, I'm not the one that needs to be persuaded.
Amen. Amen.
It said that Abraham was persuaded.
That's right.
You the one got to be persuaded.
Amen.
I'm the one that's got to be persuaded. It is not God that we're trying to persuade. When you're praying, God said, oh, I don't need you to persuade me. I need you to bring me a promise.
Amen.
I need you to bring me something that you are fixed on, that you believe with all your heart, that you are persuaded that I will do it. Because you have found it in my word.
Amen.
You have read it in my word, and you are fixed on it. And you know that if you bring this to me, I am going to do it. I am going to do it. That is the confidence. The confidence comes from me knowing he's going to do it. Why? Because I found a promise. And when I found that promise, I don't need to be persuaded. You can't unpersuade me. I found it in God's word, and God is going to do it.
Amen.
Glory, hallelujah. And Exodus, amen. Exodus 32, amen. Here's a case. It says, and the Lord said unto Moses, I have seen this people, and behold, it is stiff-necked people. Now, therefore, let me alone, that my wrath may wax hot against them, and that I may consume them, and I will make of thee a great nation. God said, I'm sick of these people. Them people don't got a golden calf, and they're saying that this golden calf is what has brought them out of Egypt. I'm sick of them. Let me consume these folk, Moses. I'm going to make you another nation. And Moses besought the Lord his God and said, Lord, why do thy wrath wax hot against thy people, which thou hast brought forth out of the land of Egypt with great power and with a mighty hand? Wherefore should the Egyptians speak and say, for mischief did he bring them out, to slay them in the mountains and to consume them from the face of the earth? Turn from thy wrath, that fierce wrath, and repent of this evil against thy people. This is Moses talking to God. Say, God, you don't brought these people out of Egypt.
That's good.
Why are you upset with them? Why are you talking about killing these folk?
Yeah.
You don't brought them out. Look at what the Egyptians are going to say. You brought them out just to kill them.
Come on.
You brought them out. That God, you brought them out with your power and your might.
Amen.
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 Amen. Remember Abraham? Uh-oh. Let me go to a case.
Yeah.
Let me find something in the word of God that I can fix myself on.
Amen.
Let me find myself something that I can be fully persuaded on. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, thy servants, to whom thou sware by thine own self and said unto them, I will multiply your seed as the stars of heaven, and all this land that I have spoken of will I give unto your seed, and I shall inherit it forever. Say, wait a minute, God. These people you're talking about killing are the seed of Abraham.
Come on.
They're the same ones that you said would multiply, that you will bless, that you will take care of, and now you're talking about killing. I said, wait a minute. He has boldly come to me.
Come on.
He has brought to me my own word. And I've said that my word will endure forever. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my word,
come on,
will endure forever. It said, and the Lord repented of the evil which he thought to do. And I said, I can't do it. I can't kill these folk. I'm gonna change my mind on it.
Come on.
Why did he do that? Because Moses brought to his remembrance.
Amen. Amen.
Huh? Amen. He brought it to his remembrance.
That's right.
What he had said, that he was gonna multiply that seed. Me and you are part of that seed.
What?
Everything God said to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, he has said to you and I.
What?
Glory. Why you ain't blessed? Because you ain't found the promise.
Come on.
Because you keep going to crying and in pity and in sympathy and thinking, God gonna answer my prayer because he know what I'm in. Yeah, he know what you in. The same way he was about to kill them folk.
Come on.
Come on now.
Amen.
He got to be bound.
Yes, he does.
He got to be bound.
Yeah.
He wants us to do it. He wants us to, see, you listen. The reason you have fear, we have fear about doing it, because we say, oh, that's God. Well, God has given us to come boldly to him.
That's right.
He didn't say, don't come boldly, and then we're being sinful coming boldly. God said, come boldly. I read the two verses to you first. Come boldly to the throne of grace.
That's right.
Amen.
Huh? Amen. You think Moses, all the folk, hard-headed, he leading all the people, you think he was a wimp? You think he was a pushover? God sent him when he was 80 years old. He wasn't no pushover. He was a bold man. He was a man that believed God. In Genesis, amen. See, had Moses not knew the Lord, and he won't be able to, you can't repeat something that you haven't read yourself.
Yeah.
You can't be fully persuaded if you're not studying this word. A lot of folk don't come to church with their Bibles. I know you got it on your phone, but I've been telling you in this church, get you a Bible.
Yeah.
Amen.
I'm sometimes up here preaching with my pad and other stuff popping up.
Yeah.
Got Coke commercials and stuff jumping up on my phone. I got to mind them down just to get back to the word. I don't ever have that problem with my Bible.
Amen.
Get you something like this. Get you something that you can go in your closet with. That you ain't got to worry about a text message coming through. Amen. So look what did Moses see? This is what Moses read. To be able to tell God that. He said, and it said, this is in Genesis, and said, by myself have I sworn, said the Lord, for because thou hast done this thing and hast not withheld thy son, thine only son. Who's he talking to? Abraham. And when he told Abraham, take your son and to slay his son, God said, listen, because you didn't hold your own son, your only son, he said, this was that in blessings I will bless thee, and in multiplying I will multiply thy seed.
Amen.
So that's what Moses took. He said, oh God, remember back in Genesis with Abraham? Because he obeyed you. You said you was gonna multiply the seed. Yeah. Well, this is the seed. You cannot kill these folk and give me a new nation. Because this nation came from Abraham.
All right,
now. All right. Amen. And what did God do? God repented.
Amen.
Because he took his word to him. He took his word to him in prayer. He didn't just go in prayer crying. He took his word to him, didn't he? Amen. And that's what God is expecting us to do. God is expecting us to bring his word. Amen. bring his word, binding principles, amen. You know, a precedence is something that has already happened.
Yeah.
Already, the precedence, it's already happened on our job when they establish a precedence, and then, you know, your boss man, he let somebody else off 5 days. You found out about it. Now you go to him and he say, you can only be off 3 days. And you say, wait a minute, boss. You let Brian off for 5 days. And what is he going to do? He's going to have to follow that. Or you're going to probably sue him. Because he set up precedence. Every owner, every boss is very careful about setting precedence.
Yeah.
Because once you do, you got to stick with him.
That's right. Amen.
I said, once you do, you got to stick with it.
Amen.
I said again, once you do it, you got to stick with it. God didn't set those things in the blind. When he said something, he said it because he wanted us to come back to him and get the same thing that he gave somebody else. He wants you to be able to come to him the same way Moses came. If Moses got it, in his generation, we'll get it in our generation. Hallelujah. Come on, give the Lord a hand of praise. Yeah. Well, I can get to go in my closet with this thing. I know God gonna work on that corner.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. Some people just lost and they just have turned away from God. They believe Jesus in their heart. But they run up on some bad times. They didn't hear the word. They didn't grow up in church, but they believe that there is a Jesus.
Yeah.
They are still a part of the seed of Abraham.
Yeah.
And God said that he will bless them.
Yeah.
And we're going to remind God of what he said.
Yeah.
And I'm telling you what God is doing. God is not sitting up there saying, I don't want to be reminded. He's saying, I wish that none would perish.
Amen.
I'm glad they're going to bring, I'm glad y'all going to come to me with that.
Amen.
But you can't just ask him about it.
Come on.
We got to have a fixed position.
That's right.
Our mind has got to be fixed.
Amen.
You got to know on the deep parts of you that God's going to do this. God's going to bring me out of this. My situation, my problems, my issue, my lack has nothing to do with what God's going to do.
Amen.
My faith has everything to do. Me believing God, me being fixed on it, has everything to do with it.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. In 2 Chronicles 2 and 7, it says, then there came some that told Jehoshaphat, saying, there cometh a great multitude against thee from beyond the sea on this side of Syria. This side of Syria. And Judea gathered themselves together to ask help of the Lord, even out of all the cities of Judah. They came to seek the Lord. And Jehoshaphat stood in the congregation of Judea and Jerusalem in the house of the Lord before the new court, and said, O Lord, God of our fathers, art not thou God in heaven? And rulest not thou over all the kingdoms of the heathens? And in thy hand is there not power and might, so that none is able to withstand thee? Art not thou our God, who didst drive out the inhabitants of this land before thy people Israel, and gave it to the seed of Abraham, that free and forever? Huh?
Yeah.
He's reminding God of who he is.
That's right.
He's reminding God of who he is. It's not that God forgot. But when we bring things to God, remembrance.
Amen.
When we bring things to God, God knows we know.
Amen.
Amen.
Our God, will thou not judge them? For we have no might against this great company that cometh against us. Neither know we what to do, but our eyes are up on you. How many times have you been in a situation Say, God, I don't know what to do. But I'm your child. And you said that you would drive out the heathens. That means them folk that's against you. You're going to drive them out. Then you say that, God, you're all powerful. I'm the seed of Abraham. I believe in Jesus Christ. In Galatians it says, if you are Christ, if you are in Christ, then you are seed of Abraham. Then you are heir to the seed, you are heir to Abraham. So we're heirs. Heirs to everything that God blessed Abraham with. Everything that God did with Abraham, God said he's going to do with you. Everything. That's the promise. That's the promise of God. And this is what God responds. And he said, hearken ye all Judea and the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and thou King Jehoshaphat, thus saith the Lord unto you, be not afraid, nor dismayed. This man, he don't know what to do. You ain't got no plan. He said, don't not have a plan. Don't worry about your plan. Don't be dismayed. He said, by reason of this great multitude, for the battle is not yours, but God's. Before he prayed, before he began to do all that, he prayed and he fasted. All of Judea prayed and fasted. And I'm telling you something, we pray and we fast and we see nothing happen. We pray and we fast and we see nothing happen. And the reason we don't is because praying and fasting is good. And I'm not disqualifying that. It's good. We need to pray. We need to fast. We need to fast when we pray. We ought to have a life of fasting and praying. But if we don't know the promise of God, if we don't know what God promised, all you're doing is not eating.
Come on.
You don't know what this word say? All you did is miss you a couple of meals. Because what they did was they fasted and they prayed and they said, God, this is who you are. This is who you are, and we know who you are. And we know what you have done. And we not only know who you are, we know who you say we are.
Amen.
And we know what you said you would do to our enemies. So I'm not, Jehoshaphat, they were outnumbered. No way they could have won this battle. Some of you sitting here, you're outnumbered. And you go to God and you say, Lord, I know I haven't been good. Lord, I know I haven't been coming to church. I know I haven't been paying my tithes. I haven't been doing this. I haven't been doing that. Right there, you're consulting your flesh.
That's right. Amen. That's right.
And you're measuring what God's going to do against what you have done.
That's right.
Or not done. And when we do that, when we do that, we're not fixed on our position.
That's right.
Mm-mm. We're not fixed on our position. Because we think this got something to do with what God's going to do. Right. No, you being fixed and having confidence in God. Yeah. My God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. That's what do it. Prayer seeking God, fasting has preceded some cases of the promises. And we should fast and we should pray, but not without having a petition, having a promise that we have found in this word. And church, this is what I'm saying to you this morning. If you should carry your Bible with you. What should prompt you before you pray, you got something you want God to do? Find that promise in his word. And don't take it to him until you are fixed on it. Until you are fully persuaded that God will do what he said he will do. Amen. Don't take him sympathy and don't take him pity. Take him a promise. Take a promise to him. That's what he's saying. Bring me a promise. Bring me your faith and bring me a promise and be fixed on it. Don't matter what your situation is. Don't matter what your condition is. What matters is your faith. And are you fixed? So that when you come in to me, you're going to pray boldly. God, let me show you what I found in your word. God, right home, and right over here in Genesis, you said. God, you said. God, this whole book was inspired by your spirit. These authors didn't just write this book off the top of their head, but they were inspired by the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
So if this is in here, it's a promise. God, if you get a chance, you know we need some food. God, you know my car is broke down. I need you to do it. You never get a car. He's going to feed you because he take care of the birds and the sparrows and all that stuff. He provides for the lilies in the field. So you'll get a little something, but you'll never get what you can get by faith. You'll never get what you can get by believing. God, you established my relationship.
Yes.
You said marriage was good in this Bible.
Yes, yes, yes.
God, you said it's good, but we're going through some trouble. God, I need you to fix it.
Glory.
You said you're supposed to treat me like Christ. Love me like Christ loved the church.
Amen.
Huh? That's in your word, God.
Right.
I'm bringing that to you. I'm bringing this word.
Amen.
That's in your word that was inspired by your spirit. I'm bringing it to you, Lord.
Right.
Amen. Amen. I'm just about finished. Psalms 44. Amen. So we have heard with our ears, O God, our Father, have told us what work thou didst in their days, in the time of old, how thou didst drive out the heathens with thy hand and planted them. Now, how thou didst afflict the people and cast them out. For they got not the land in possession by their own sword, neither did their own arm save them, but thy right hand and thine arm and the light of thy countenance, because thou hast favor unto them that are my king, O God. Command deliverance for Jacob. Through thee will we push down our enemies. Through thy name will we tread them under that rise up against us. For I will not trust in my bow, neither shall my sword save me. But thou hast saved us from our enemy and hast put them to shame that hate us. The psalmist is saying, what you did for Jacob, do for me.
Amen.
Amen.
I ain't got to worry about my sword. I ain't got to worry about this. What you did for Jacob, Lord, do it for me.
Amen.
Yeah. Why can he do it for Jacob? Because he made the promise to Abraham. And Abraham was in the bloodline and in the lineage of an heir to Jacob was an heir to it. We're heirs too. He said, you did it in that generation, do it in this generation.
Amen.
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 Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
With mercy in our hearts and humility in our hearts, we go to God boldly.
Amen.
Not apologetic.
Yeah.
Being apologetic is not bold. God said, bring it to me.
Amen.
Come boldly to me. You found it, come boldly to me. Amen. Amen. My boldness comes from knowing who God is and what he has done in the past.
Amen.
Your boldness comes from knowing who God is.
Amen.
And what God has done in the past.
Yes.
Where do you get that boldness? You can't have boldness if you don't know what he did.
Yes.
Who he is.
Yes.
And what he has done in the past.
Yes.
My God, my God.
Yes.
My God, my God. boldness comes from knowing who he is.
Glory.
And what he's already done.
Yes.
Causes you to be fixed on your position.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Matthew 18:19. That's my last one. Matthew 18:18. So verily I say unto you, whatsoever ye shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. And whatsoever ye shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. When we bind, that word bind in the Greek, it means fixed position. If you look it up, that's why I got fixed position. In the Greek, it means fixed position. A fixed position.
Amen.
That's what it means. Whatever you have a fixed position on, whatever you are fixed on, you're fixed. Meaning, I know it, I found it, I know God said he would do it, I'm fixed on it. That's binding.
Amen.
He says, whatever you loose on earth will be loose in heaven. And the Greek loose is to crush. It's to take a hammer and to just pulverize it, to just crush it. You just beat that thing down. The lies the devil have told us, when we beat those things down here, God beat them down in heaven. When we're fixed on something here by binding, and binding is definitely the enemy attacking something, and we bind that thing that the enemy has attacked. We're fixed on it. And whenever we bind on this earth, we're simply fixed on it. And whatever we loose, we're crushing it. We're destroying it. And God said he's doing the same thing. He's doing the same thing in heaven. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God.
Glory to God.
Amen. Amen. Praise God. Come on, stand up, Jesus. Hallelujah. No pity, no sympathy, no emotions, but answered prayers. Answered prayers. How many unanswered prayers do you have? How many unanswered prayers? How many times have you gone to pray? You say, I've prayed and I've prayed and I've prayed. I don't even pray anymore because nothing seems to happen. God doesn't move on my prayer. Well, the only reason you can say that, because the Bible said that God answers prayers. The only reason you can say that is because, like me, I was once praying and nothing happened. Some Saturday nights I would not even be prepared to stand before you on Sunday morning. Wake up early on Sunday morning and be pulling something together. Not feeling the presence of God. I'll never do that again. I'll never ever do that again. But it was because, you know, I wasn't praying and hearing from God. But now I hear from God because what I share with you today is how I've been living.
Amen.
Amen.
And I don't make any apologies. Because God don't want you to make any apologies.
Amen.
He says, if you love me, keep my commandments.
Amen.
Amen.
Follow my instructions. When God said he wants us to be bold, he wants us to be bold. The Jesus that's in us is bold.
Amen.
He's not a coward. He's not fearful. Sickness come upon your body, you can't be fearful. You can't measure what's going on in your life. Be thinking, well, this is happening because of this, or this is happening because of that. I tell you, church, whatever you're going through today, there's a promise in here that you can carry to God. Don't go to God in prayer without a promise. If you got to go in your closet or go in your prayer place and open your Bible and read it to God. God, you remember when you said this?
All right.
This is what I need you to do for me.
Yeah.
And you know what you do after you say that to God? You know what you do after you say that to God? You rejoice.
Amen.
You rejoice. Thank you, Lord. You rejoice because he's going to do it.
Amen.
You rejoice and you say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. God is faithful, church. Make him unfaithful. And he don't need to be persuaded. He doesn't need to be persuaded. God is not looking for you to persuade him to do something. He said you need to be persuaded that what I said I'll do, I'll do. That's why Abraham, it says Abraham believed God and was accounted unto him as righteousness. Then it goes on to say that Abraham was fully persuaded that what God said he would do, that he would do it.
Yeah.
Abraham wasn't perfect in the beginning. He made some mistakes in the beginning. But that's okay. He didn't continue to keep making those mistakes. But he was persuaded. Listen, I'm going to say this. I pray I can get it in your head. Abraham was persuaded. He knew that what God said he could do, he could do it. It didn't keep him from sleeping with Hagar. It didn't keep him from lying to Pharaoh when he said, this is my sister, or King Abimelech when he said, this is my sister. It didn't keep, he believed God. And the reason God delivered him from Pharaoh, made him rich. He went in a liar, came out a rich liar. Did the same thing with King Abimelech. Went in a liar, came out a rich liar. Because God said, even though he lied, I'm not measuring him by that. I'm not measuring him by what he said. In fear, in time, he'll get over that. He says, I'm only looking at the fact that he has a fixed position on me.
Amen.
That he knows what I've said, I'll do. King Abimelech, women in his kingdom could not have any babies because God had shut up the womb. They couldn't have any children. And God told King Abimelech, the same man that lied to you, he is a prophet. And he'll come in and he'll pray for the women in your kingdom. And I'll open up their womb so they can start having children. This man's a liar, God. He lied to this man. This man, this king only did what he did because Abraham lied to him. God said, I don't want him to lie. But that's not in the equation. What's in the equation is he is fixed on the promise that I had made. That I made to him. Pharaoh and Abimelech both wanted his wife Sarah, and Sarah was 90-something years old. She had never had a child. Now, This woman 90 years old, she must look like something for them to want her. She had to look nice to be 90-something years old, and both of them wanted her. When they had all the young women they could have brought into their harem, they wanted Sarah. So it's something they were seeing that Abraham had not yet saw. I'm saying this to you. The promise that he had made to Abraham was already working. He couldn't see it. The promise God has made to you is already working. Abraham didn't keep doing that. He didn't keep lying. He didn't keep, you know, sleeping around. He didn't keep doing that. You won't lie to me when you believe God. As we believe God, see, you don't bring, you know, God see you perfect. Right now, you come to him, he said, you are perfect. You're not getting perfect. God said, you are perfect. But we know we are perfecting every day. But God already see you. He already see you that way. So when you make a mistake, don't trip on it. Repent. And still be persuaded. Still be fixed on what he has said. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Come on, lift your hands. God, we are so thankful. I'm so thankful, Lord, that you could speak through me your word that you want us to hear this morning. God, I'm so thankful that I'm of little strength. We are of little strength. Because of that, you can be our strength. Because of that, you can strengthen us, Lord. God, help our unbelief. Remove doubt and unbelief from us, God. And let us stand firmly on your word, firmly on what you have said. Let us have a fixed position as Moses had. And God, let us boldly come to you, not because we come out of fear or because we come out of being angry or mad, but because we have found a promise in your word that we need to work in our life. And let us boldly come and remind you and bring to your remembrance as Moses brought to your remembrance. Let us bring the promise to your remembrance. And we are confident and we are fixed that whatever you have said, you will perform. You will perform. We're persuaded, Lord. We are persuaded that your word will stand when everything else is gone. That your word, dear God, has power all by itself, Lord. And we are persuaded, God. We're fixed. And we know, God. We know you, Lord. Nobody in this Bible that you bless through pity or sympathy or emotions. You bless them, God. You answered their prayers because they were persistent. Because they stood there. Because they knew. They knew that you were able to do it. They knew your heart that you were willing to do it.
Hallelujah.
You had done it before.
Thank you, Lord.
And you're the same. You changed not, Lord. And we thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
In Jesus' name we pray, Lord. Amen. Listen, if you're here this morning, you're in need of prayer. We don't want to deny you of prayer. You're here this morning and you're Say, Pastor, I'm here. I just need prayer. Whether you're weak in your body, there's something going on in you, and you just need prayer. Sometimes people come to church and they smile on the outside, but they're hurting on the inside.
Yes.
Maybe that's you. Maybe you're smiling on the outside, and you don't want anybody to know how bad you're hurting on the inside. But the reason I'm saying it this morning is because God already knows.
Yes, he does.
And he says you're in a place where he can take that hurt away from you.
Yes, yes, yes.
Where he can deal with that hurt.
Yes.
It don't belong to you.
No.
The battle is not yours.
Amen.
Today you can give it to the Lord.
Amen.
We'll pray with you, we'll pray for you. Whatever the situation is, we invite you to come now.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Praise God. Father, we thank you for blessing the families that are here, dear God. Strengthening every home in the name of Jesus. God, we thank you, Lord. Being so good and so faithful to us, Lord. God, you've been so good. We just love you today, Lord. Thank you for meeting our needs. Thank you, Lord, for bringing us home, God. Those who are watching us while we stream live, God, we pray that you would bless them, Lord. Bless them, dear God. Touch their hearts, oh God. Let them find in your word, dear God, a promise, dear God, and let them fix their hearts on that promise, dear God, and let them be fully persuaded, God, that what you said you will do, dear God. Father, let them boldly come to the throne of grace for help, God, not wavering, not measuring their failures and their problems against what your word has said, God, but only looking to you, Lord, only looking to you for help. Bless them, oh God. I believe in
to believe.
Amen. Pastor Monique's going to come and pray. Amen. For our prayer corner project. Amen.
Heavenly Father, we thank you. Father God, we thank you that you have already given us dominion. We thank you that you have already given us authority with your name. We thank you that you have already given us your precious blood. Lord, we thank you that you already told us to go and make disciples out of every nation. So, Lord, we take that call. We take that command as our responsibility. In the name of Jesus, dear God. You said that my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray, seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. Then shall I hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and I will heal the land. And that's our prayer, dear God, of our prayer corner, that you would heal the land. That you would heal the land in this community, Lord, in the name of Jesus, because you created them. You created them for purpose, Lord. Those are the teachers and the preachers and the prophets, dear God. That's the next generation, Lord. The army of the Lord, Heavenly Father. In the name of Jesus. So, Father God, we use that authority and we come against every stronghold over this community with your name and with your blood, Lord. We bind you in the name of Jesus. We command you to be destroyed. We command you to come on down in the name of Jesus. Oh, Father, I thank you for restoration. Restoration, I thank you for souls being saved. We ask you for souls. We ask you, Lord, because you are the God of the harvest, that you send laborers into your harvest to disciple them, Lord. We pray that they come into the knowledge of you. We pray, Lord, that they know that in you there's peace, in you there's joy, in you there's hope, in you there's life to live on this earth in the name of Jesus, Heavenly Father. And Lord, when we go and we tread upon that corner, dear God, I thank you that we take over and that it belongs to us in the name of Jesus. And I thank you, Lord, that they will begin to come here and hear your word and be changed, dear God, and become disciples themselves in the name of Jesus. And God, I thank you that people will know that there's healing in you, no matter how long they've been sick, no matter what the condition is, no matter what research is.
Outside of these walls.
Glory.
Praise God. Amen. It's good to receive the Holy Communion on today. Amen. Praise God. It's just medicine for your body. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. On that day, amen, Jesus said, this is my body, which is broken for you. Amen. He was talking to the disciples, and he was talking to us, and he was setting it in place that this is the body of Christ. And because he said that, we believe it. And it's a promise to us. And let me tell you, whatever's going on in your body, this bread can heal your body right now. There's no sickness, no disease in this body. He said, we are as he is in this world today. So when you receive this and you discern him, you discern that I'm taking this because it is the body of my Savior. He is the bread of life, the bread that gives me eternal life. This piece, this wafer will not sustain us, but Jesus will. He said his blood is the new covenant. And all of our sins, say all of my sins.
All of my sins.
That's why you can boldly go to him, because all of your sins are under this blood.
Yeah.
It's under the blood. And when you remember Jesus, you are thankful. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for dying on that cross. Thank you for your blood that's shed for me. And they ate and drank together. The Bible says as often as you do so the Lord's death until he comes. And we do it every Sunday. Every Sunday we receive. Every Sunday this year, maybe the last 2 or 3 years, we receive communion. Amen. Now listen, if you're here and you say, I'm here and I don't have a relationship with Jesus. I don't know Jesus as my Lord and Savior. I haven't received them in my heart, and I don't know that if I were to die today that I would have eternal life with him. And I don't want to take a chance. I want to know that I'm saved. I want to know Jesus as my personal Savior. If you're here and you don't know him, I'm inviting you to come now. If you're standing next to somebody, just ask them, say, do you know Jesus? Make sure, disciple them, make sure they know Jesus. And make sure you ask them, do you know Jesus? Do you know Jesus? Do you have Jesus in your heart? Have you received Jesus as your Lord? There's a lot of things to play with, but this is not one of them. Do you know Jesus? Are you sure? Are you sure? Because he said many will say on that day, Lord, Lord. He said, I never knew you. Are you sure? Don't stand there and not be sure. Maybe you say, I know him. I have a relationship with him. I'm just looking for a place to call home. I'm looking for a place to grow. If you're here and you say, I just need a place to call home, a place where I can grow. And I believe, I know that the Spirit of the Lord is leading me to be here. I'm inviting you to come now. Just come. This is what God is touching and pricking your heart. I invite you to come now. Amen. 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 Well, let us prepare our hearts.